My name is Dr. Raoul McLaughlin, and my subject is trade beyond the Roman frontiers. I have published several books on this subject. I am a member of the Council of the Classical Association of Northern Ireland, and I am on the Council of the Classical Association of Ireland. The question is, how did the Roman Empire propose to deal with the frontier between occupied Britain and free Ireland? The text of this reading is available from the journal Classics Ireland. The ancient evidence suggests that in the 1st century AD, the Roman Empire planned to conquer the island they called Hibernia. But what did they know about Ireland? In AD 43, the Emperor Claudius began the conquest of Britain, believing that it would reinforce his military reputation and gain him political glory. When the Roman Empire established a province in southern Britain, resistance fighters found refuge in Wales, where they were able to regroup into war bands and attack imperial-held territory. In AD 48, the Roman governor, Ostorius Scapula, led a retaliatory campaign westwards to subdue Wales, and he had almost reached the sea facing Hibernia, Ireland, when disturbances in central Britain forced him to abandon these military operations. During this period, the Welsh island of Mona, Anglesey, had become a stronghold of resistance against the Roman Empire. Anglesey is situated on the west coast of Britain, only a day's sailing from Ireland. Tacitus describes Anglesey as an island from which the rebels draw reinforcements, and an enemy stronghold with a strong population providing shelter for fugitives. In AD 61, the legions, under the Roman governor Suetonius Paulinus, marched on Anglesey. A rebel army, incited by druids and torch-carrying black-clad priestesses, had gathered on the other side to oppose the Roman assault. Suetonius conveyed his troops across the narrow quarter-mile Menai Straits, and Tacitus describes how the Romans followed their standards into battle and cut down all they met. They burned them in the flames of their own torches. The remaining defenders were butchered, and the island's sacred sites burnt. But once again, military plans to subdue Britain were interrupted as Paulinus learnt that the Iceni queen Boadicea had rebelled against Rome and was threatening Colchester and Londinium. The Roman province had been devastated, but Paulinus found a suitable battleground and defeated the rebels with a force of 10,000 soldiers. At this time, the Romans knew little about the geography of northern Britain beyond the Pennines. Writing in AD 75, Pliny the Elder records that in nearly 30 years, Roman forces have explored Britain, but only as far as the Caledonian Forest. By contrast, Ireland was well known to Roman traders, as the Atlantic seaboard was an important thoroughfare for the movement of peoples, goods, and cultural ideas. The discovery of a Barbary ape skull, dating from before 20 BC at Navan in Armagh, confirms contacts between ancient Ireland and the seagoing peoples of southern Iberia, Spain. The Greek geographer Ptolemy refers to a merchant named Philemon, whose reckonings make the width of the island of Hibernia 20 days' journey from east to west. The figures came from direct reports, and Philemon said that he himself had heard this information from the merchants themselves. These Roman visitors spent time at two inland sites, one in Connacht and the other in Munster, where they measured the longest day at the summer equinox. This was the information that Roman geographers needed to calculate the approximate size and northern latitude of the island. The Romans knew that Ireland was a large and well-populated island which possessed rich pasture lands suitable for stock-rearing. The Roman geographer Mella describes how Irish cattle could suffer from bloat, a build-up of gas in the abdomen that occurs when animals with an obstructed digestive system are allowed to overgraze. He reports that Ireland is so luxuriant with abundant and sweet grass that livestock fill themselves in a fraction of a day, Unless they are restrained, they rupture from feeding too long. As a consequence, the Celts called the island Iweru, meaning the fat or fertile land, and this name entered the Latin language as Iverna, Hibernia. Cattle were a valuable product in ancient society, and the Roman army needed hard-wearing leather for military footwear, belts, straps, and harnesses. Campaign equipment also required leather for tents, grain sacks, and water storage skins that could be also be inflated as buoyancy aids. So important was leather that in some Rhineland regions, the Roman army was tasked with collecting tribal taxes in ox hides rather than cash payments. A Roman writing tablet from this frontier records that a soldier could purchase a cow for 115 denarii, at a time when one silver coin was a generous day's pay for a legionary. Eventually, Roman plans to eradicate resistance and conquer Britain were reassessed by a senior general named Vespasian, who became emperor in AD 69. Vespasian had early experience in Britain as a legionary commander during the invasion of AD 43, in charge of the 2nd Augustan Legion. He led his men into the Cornish Peninsula to seize its lucrative tin mines and natural harbours. During these campaigns, Vespasian conducted seaborne operations to capture the offshore island of Vectis, the Isle of Wight. These experiences shaped his views on the feasibility of conquests across the Irish Sea. Most of the information from this period comes from the Roman historian Tacitus. He was the son-in-law of Gnaeus Julius Agricola, the governor of Britain between AD 77 and 84. Tacitus wrote a short account of Agricola's life, which provides important references to Ireland. According to Tacitus, "In soil and climate, in disposition and lifestyle of its population, Ireland differs little from Britain. The routes of approach and harbours are better known to us through commerce and merchants." One major problem the Romans faced in securing Britain was hundreds of miles of coastline stretching from Cornwall to Scotland. As long as Ireland remained unconquered, renegades from Britain would find refuge only a short sea journey away. Tacitus argued that Britain would be more profitable if Roman forces were everywhere and freedom was removed from view. By annexing Ireland, the Romans would strengthen territories bordering the Atlantic Ocean. Tacitus explains, "Ireland is positioned between Britain and Spain and is conveniently situated for the Gallic Sea. It would unite the most powerful part of the empire with great mutual benefit." In AD 77, Vespasian offered Julius Agricola the governorship of Britain, including the command of 4 legions, 40,000 soldiers. Agricola had previous military experience in Britain as a young tribune with Suetonius Paulinus when the Roman army attacked Anglesey in AD 61. In AD 70, he had returned to Britain to command the 20th Legion before serving as governor of the Atlantic-facing province of Aquitaine in Gaul. Archaeological evidence from this period suggests that the Romans were preparing a combined fortress and fleet base called Derva Victrix as their new provincial capital. Derva, on the River Dee, modern Chester, was positioned on the west coast of Britain, facing Ireland, a distance of 130 miles. The legionary fort at Derva was 1/5 larger than other military bases established in Britain during this era, and at its centre were the foundations of a unique elliptical building that was possibly the governor's headquarters or an imperial temple. Lead water pipes in the foundations were stamped with name and titles of Vespasian and Agricola. When Agricola took command in AD 77, his likely tasks were to pacify Britain, establish secure northern frontiers bordering on Caledonia, and prepare the legions for the conquest of Ireland. but his first objective was to eradicate the remaining resistance in Wales. He led an immediate assault on Anglesey, using specially selected auxiliary soldiers to swim the narrow Menai Straits. Agricola then set about annihilating the Ordovices, a tribe in the Welsh mountains who had repeatedly opposed Roman rule. The following year, AD 78, Agricola began operations to ensure that the Brigantes in central Britain were fully pacified. This campaign was managed from the newly established headquarters of the 9th Legion at Eboracum, York, on the eastern side of Britain. In AD 79, Agricola extended the Roman campaign into southern Caledonia, where he met his second objective and created a viable northern frontier between the Clyde and Forth estuaries. Tacitus describes these estuaries as immense tidal inlets divided by a narrow strip of land. Here Agricola established a line of guard forts that cut the Roman land border to a 40-mile barrier across the isthmus. Beyond this defensive line lay the inhospitable highlands and the forests of northern Caledonia. On the plains of the east coast, Agricola pushed forward to the Tay estuary, and according to Tacitus, the Romans struck so much terror into the enemy that they did not dare challenge the army. Caledonia was sealed off from the rest of Britain to become what might be called another island. Roman governors usually held office for 3 years, but when the Emperor Vespasian died in June AD 79, his eldest son Titus permitted Agricola to remain in command. Titus took his 15th imperial acclamation in late AD 79 to signal that Roman conquests in Britain were complete. For further information, please see part 2 of this talk. Subscribe to my channel and follow the links to my books, The Roman Empire and the Indian Ocean, and The Roman Empire and the Silk Routes. Thank you.